Good morning. Here is the person who is doing the announcements today.
Sorry, someone told me a really important announcement. I wanted to write it down. Didn't realize I had that little time to remember. Well, hello. So there's a couple of things going on this week. Tomorrow, Emily and I and Rick are headed off to camp with all of our teens and our kids. We're either brave or crazy. So we are actually not meeting at Oak Ridge. We're meeting at Park Place Wesleyan. We're going to ride a bus with them since we're now going to camp a little farther away than we usually are. So if you are headed to camp, you need to be there at 10:45. Okay? All right. And group is still meeting on Wednesdays. They didn't take a summer break. So make sure if you're going to group that you're still going. And we have a really special birthday today. Did you know it was Mike's birthday? Happy birthday, Mike! Woo! All right.
And now I'm going to pray as the worship team comes forward. Gracious Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for this day again, Lord God. Thank you for bringing us back here. Thank you for your Spirit, Lord. Thank you for all of the goodness you provide in our lives. We know it all comes from you, God. Thank you so much for bringing Pastor Christia home safely. We know she's still on sabbatical, Lord. And I just pray that you would continue to bless that time for her. Continue to speak into her life, Lord God. Speak into us today during this service, Lord. Let us hear what it is you want us to hear. Use Pastor John, Lord God, and everybody else who's here to speak. To use them to speak for you and through them, Lord God. And through all of us each and every day. Help us to be bold disciples for you, Lord Jesus. We need you. God, we need you every day. Please be with those of us who are going to camp, Lord. Help us through this week. Help us to pour into these children, Lord God, the counselors, and just help us to feel that Holy Spirit touch from you, counselors and kids, Lord God. And we just give you all the praise and glory. Let this service be blessed in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Well, we'd invite you to stand with us this morning, and our first song is a song that hopefully you either clap along or move along, wake up a little bit as we celebrate the love that Jesus has and the relationship that he desires to have with us this morning.
Lay our burdens down.
Are you awake this morning, Oak Ridge? Do you believe that God desires to be with you in your life? That Jesus chooses you and calls you friend? I no longer call you disciples. I call you my friends. You know me. You've heard my voice speak into your life. It is by grace you have been saved and redeemed into him. And this morning, we just want to continue to tune our hearts into God's goodness, his grace, his love, and his presence with us this morning as we worship him.
You heavens, let the praise go. Jesus, light of heaven, friend forever, his kingdom come.
Love the chorus of that song. It says, don't let your heart be troubled, but hold your head up high. Don't fear anything evil, but fix your eyes on this truth, that God so loved the world, he sent his only son, Jesus Christ, to die on a cross for you. He is so madly in love with you that you can take courage this morning. Hold on and be strong and remember our help comes from him, the one who loves us, who died for us, who created us, who redeems us and sustains us and has a plan and a purpose for us. This morning, we want to offer the opportunity, if you'd like to come forward to the altars and kneel in prayer, you're welcome to do so. We're going to sing a song, and then we're going to just have a moment of just kind of special and corporate prayer together, but you're welcome to come forward and just kneel as we prepare to sing this song together. We just want to thank you this morning for your presence. We thank you for your love for each one of us, and thank you that God, you choose us. In the midst of brokenness, in the midst of fear, in the midst of despair, you come into our world. You step into the darkness that is our lives, and according to the gospel, you are the light. And the darkness cannot overcome the light. And the light shines in the midst of the darkness and says, there is a new kingdom, there is a new way. Fear does not hold you captive. Anxiety can no longer hold you captive. Sin cannot hold you captive from all that God desires to bring into your life. And so this morning, Jesus, we come. In And you've asked us to come just as we are, not to come with false pretenses of our own personal holiness and our own strength and our own ability to get it right, but God, just to come as we are and to lay it down before you. And God, you step into the midst of our mess, and Jesus takes that mess upon himself and wears it on the cross and says, it is crucified. It is separated from you as far as the east is from the west. You do not have to wear it. It does not have to be your identity. It does not have to be your reality of what you walk in if you look to me. So this morning, God, we take an act of worship. But as we worship, we recognize that this is spiritual battle, and we step into the truth of what your word says. We deny the kingdoms of this world. We deny the temptations and the weaknesses and the failures and the doubts. And we see your goodness. We see the grace of Jesus Christ on the cross. We see the friendship that he has as he chooses and loves us. And God, we align ourselves with you, with your kingdom. We take hold of the gift that you make available through Jesus. God, we ask that your presence would be with us, that your strength would be with us, that you would carry us, because God, the burden is often too great for us. We can't handle it because we weren't meant to handle it. And so we give it to you, Jesus. God, we thank you for a church family. We thank you for a place that we get to go once a week and just gather together with other believers and to be reminded of your presence and of your truth. To be reminded of your kingdom that is breaking in and will have victory over the kingdoms of this world. God, I pray for this church, and I pray that your spirit would fall upon us today. That God, we would be caught up in an awareness that you are here and you are present. God, that your Holy Spirit would be like a thick cloud covering each one of us, and that we would know that what we are in right now is sacred ground, not because the building has a steeple, not because it says church on the front of it, but because your people are gathered here seeking you. God, there's nothing else that we need but you. So help us to lean to you, to look to you, to cling to you, to seek you, to pursue you with all that we have. You promise in your word that when we seek you with all of our hearts, we will find you, Jesus. Lord, we continue to pray for Pastor Christia on her sabbatical time, Lord Jesus. I thank you that her journey away was fruitful, and God, that you have kept her safe, and she's back home with her family, and so we just give you praise for that and for the work that you have done and are continuing to do in her life as she just spends this time seeking you. And God, we continue to ask that you would just so fill her with your spirit, God, that when she returns to us, that she would just carry with her, not herself, but that she would be transformed and she would bring your presence, God, with the anointing of your spirit, and that that wind and that fire that has blown into her life would flow to us. God, I thank you that while she was away, she said she had an Elijah moment, but God, for her, you spoke through the wind, you spoke through the earthquake, you spoke through the fire, you spoke through the still small voice. In all of it, you were speaking to your servant, just preparing her for what you want to do. And God, we get to be the recipients of that grace that you've given into her life as that is poured back to us. And so we just ask, God, that you would continue to allow this to be a transformative, a holy and a sacred time for her as she spends moments with you and with her family and prepares once again for the ministry to which you have called her, Jesus. Lord, I think this week of camp, what an important ministry that we have in the Florida district for our children and for our teenagers. God, there's kids from Oak Ridge, and there's teens from Oak Ridge and from all over the state of Florida that will gather together. It is a new place. It's a new campground. And so, God, I pray for Pastor Mike and Pastor Eleanor and for their teams that are directing these camps. And, God, there'll be some new things to get used to. But, God, I just pray that right now your Holy Spirit would descend upon that campground, that it would be holy and set aside sacred space, God, for what you want to do. God, I pray that these kids and these teenagers, that when they go there, that as soon as they step foot on the ground, that whatever is on their minds, I know there's so many things vying for the hearts and the souls of our kids and our teenagers, God, their lives, they're fighting the spiritual battle every day, and some of them are so painfully aware of it, and some of them are just aware that it is just pain. But I pray that, God, you would help them to step into this anointed space. God, do not let them take it for granted. God, I pray that you would call them to participate, even in the things that seem goofy, even in the things that seem weird, even in the things they think they're too cool for, because, God, it is all a part of just letting go. God, all of us need to just let go sometimes and just to allow you to have your work in our lives. And I pray for those kids and for those teens and for every adult that is going to be there that, God, your spirit would arrest their hearts, that, God, you would draw them near to you. God, some will give their lives to you for the first time. Some will commit their lives to being on fire with a holy life that is set apart for you, Jesus. Some of them may feel called to ministry, whether that's a vocational job like pastoring or a missionary, or whether that's just serving you in whatever role you call them to. But God, I pray that you would change lives, transform them, let them never be the same because they've sat in your presence. God, I'm so excited to hear the stories from our teens and our counselors and our kids. And I'm excited to hear about the district and what you do because, God, I know that this is a space that you use in our lives. And so I pray for a fresh anointing of your spirit. God, I think of our world right now. I think of the darkness that we so often pray against. We think about all these different things. We think about the government, and we think about media and entertainment, and we think about schools and the difficulty that exists in schools and in the workplace. And God, really, it wasn't all that different 2,000-ish years ago. But what began to change history was an infilling of the Holy Spirit in a group of people who loved Jesus and gathered together and said, we're ready to build this kingdom. We're just waiting on your Holy Spirit. So God, I think of these kids and teens, and I think of even us as a church gathered here today in your name. And God, my desire as a pastor is that this song would be our desire and our cry, that my Jesus, I love thee, thou art mine, that we would love and cling and desire you. And the Holy Spirit, you would allow a fresh wind of your presence to blow into our lives. That you would get our eyes off of everything going on in the kingdoms of this world and onto you, Jesus. Help us to see there's something so much greater. That our God is still at work. That he has not been defeated. The cross was not the end. There is a resurrection. There is hope. There is life. There is victory. There is eternity waiting for God's people. Help us to see you and what you're doing, not just our problems and our situation and the world around us, but to know that the Lion of Judah will defeat the enemy. He may prowl like a roaring lion, but he has already been defeated by the blood of the cross. And he will be defeated forevermore. So God, we choose to see you this morning. We lay down those burdens and those fears, those anxieties and sins. And we ask that your spirit would breathe freshly into our lives again, that we might hear from you. Even in this moment, that God, you would begin your transformative work as we surrender to you and open up our soul to receive what you desire to pour in. In Jesus' name I pray.
Side. So heaven is real and death is
open your word and prepare to hear from you, God, I ask that you would just anoint the words that are shared. God, may I not share anything this morning, but God, I ask that your spirit would speak to us and that we would hear from you, the great I am, the one who at the very mention of the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. The demons know him. They believe that he is the king. They hear his voice and shudder. And so we speak the name of Jesus over our congregation this morning. And I ask God that Jesus would be with our people, drawing them unto yourself, the great I am. It's in your name we pray, Jesus. Amen. You may be seated this morning. We do want to remind you of the opportunity to continue in worship through the giving of your tithes and offerings. There are plates available as you exit the sanctuary in either direction this morning, and you can also give online through a number of different means. If you go to oakridgewc.com/give, you'll see all of those listed there, and we just want to pray over the offering this morning. Father God, I thank you for your provision in our lives, and I pray that you would bless what is given today, that it would be used to further your kingdom. God, I pray that you would multiply what is given today, that we would have the ability to continue to do ministry in our community and for your grace and your glory. God, I pray that you would bless not only what is given, but those who give today, Jesus, by your hand and your authority. In Jesus' name I pray. At this time, we're going to go ahead and dismiss our school-aged children and volunteers for Adventure Kits. Good morning, Oak Ridge.
Good morning.
How are you today? Are you awake? All right. Shake your neighbor, say, wake up. If God has something to say, I don't want you to miss it. We're in a series where we've been looking at Elisha's life. Elisha was this prophet who lived in the Old Testament, and he had ridiculous faith. And the people around him seemed to kind of emulate this kind of crazy faith, and God just kept showing up over and over again in his life in these ways that are ridiculous. These miraculous stories that we read and go, what is going on? How does this happen? How does this happen in this guy's life again and again and again? And I don't know about you, but in my life, there's some miracles that I'm looking for and hoping for and praying for. And so the desire is to say, well, God, what can I do? What can I learn as I open your word and as I look at the life of Elisha? What are you asking of me to be a person who has ridiculous faith? And so we've said that a person of ridiculous faith is somebody who is obedient. When God calls, they say yes and they chase after him. It means that we have commitment. We're not looking for a way out of the things we've said yes to God to, but we're saying, God, I'm going to continue in the things that you've called me to because I still desire to see your miraculous hand working. It means that we love people. We have compassion, even when sometimes it doesn't make sense. We put our trust and our hope in our God. We know that he can provide for us even in miraculous ways. We become determined to pursue him, to say, no matter what I go through in life, my goal and my aim is to move closer to God and make room and space in my heart and life for him. We know that our God is a God of transformation, who can take one situation, make it something completely different, and we invite him to start with us, saying, God, transform me and my heart to somebody who loves you. And last week, we talked about how the path to experiencing God often looks like humility. This week, we're going to look at a story that talks about what it's like to recover something that has been lost. Now, I don't know if you're like me, but it absolutely drives me crazy when I lose something and I'm trying to find the thing that I lost. Now, for me, one of the number one things that I tend to lose is my cup.
In fact, my family has joked and they've told me that when I die someday, they're going to inscribe on my gravestone, "Where's my cup?" Because so often I will be at home or at the office, and whenever I have my cup, that's the cup I want. And I will carry it with me somewhere in the house or somewhere in the church, and I will inevitably set it down, and then a few moments later, I will need a drink, and I will go, "Where's my cup?" And I will start searching high and low, and it would be easy to go to the cupboard and get a new cup, but I want my cup. I want to get it back. And the worst situation, tell me I'm not the only one who does stuff like this. The worst situation is sometimes maybe I'll be like helping grill dinner and I'll be getting things ready and I'll set my cup at the dinner table. And then I go outside and I'm grilling for a little while and I run back inside and I'm helping Christina with some sides and put a few more things on the table, feed the dog, tell Jillian to wash her hands, and I'm back and forth and everything's ready, and then I go, "Where's my cup?" And I start looking, right? And I go outside and I look for it. And I go in the kitchen and I look for it. And I'm looking in Jillian's room and I'm looking in the bathroom. I'm like, where are I go out to the car. I've been in the car for hours. And I'm like, "Where is my cup?" And Jillian, sitting at the table, goes, "Dad, it's right here. It's right in front of you where you put it." It can drive us crazy trying to recover something that we've misplaced. If you have a Bible this morning, I'd invite you to get it out, and whether it's a paper Bible or maybe it's a digital Bible or maybe you forgot one and you want to borrow one of the blue Bibles in the chair rack in front of you, or open another tab on your browser if you're joining us online. But I invite you to get out your Bible and lift it up nice and high. Say, "I got my Bible, PJ." Father God, I thank you for those this morning that have your words in their hands. I pray that you would speak to them through your word. And God, if you desire to use me, then I pray that you would use me. But more than anything, God, I thank you for the gift that we hold in our hands that is your word to us, that we have it in the English language that we speak for most of us here. And God, I just thank you that we have it to read and to know you and to know these kinds of stories. And I just pray that you'd help it to come alive in our hearts once again today. Invite you to turn in that Bible, if you would, to 2 Kings chapter 6. That's where we're going to be in just a moment. And by way of a little bit of background, as we get into 2 Kings chapter 6, we're at a point in Elisha's life when several young men have begun to follow him. They want to learn from him and try to emulate his life and their lives. And the place where they've been gathering, it's gotten a little bit too small. And so they decide what we're going to do is we're going to go and we're going to build a school of sorts for learning. And one young guy borrows an iron axe, which is actually a rather valuable item at this time period, especially for a student. So I want you to think a little bit about, like, maybe you went to college and think about your college days when you're living on student loans and ramen noodles and you have not a dollar to your name. And imagine that, like, some wealthy friend of yours knows that you have a job interview and says, "Well, you can borrow the Mercedes and take it to the job interview." And so you drive out to the job interview with the Mercedes and you're being so careful, and yet you're backing out of the parking spot and wham, somebody comes through. It's something a little bit like that. We're going to be in 2 Kings chapter 6. And I'm going to take a pause real quick, see if I switch mics, if that helps me out. Can you still hear me? We'll see if that's any clearer. I'm muted. How about now? Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? Should I go out in the middle of the woods and ask if you can hear me? All right. Anyways, we're in 2 Kings chapter 6. God's word to us this morning says, "The company of the prophets said to Elisha, 'Look, the place where we meet with you is too small for us. So let us go to the Jordan where each of us can get a pole, and let us build a place there for us to meet.' And he said, 'Go.' So one of them said, 'Won't you please come with your servants?' 'I'll go with you,' Elisha said, and he went with them.
They went to the Jordan and began cutting down trees. And as one of them was cutting down a tree, the iron axe head fell into the water. "Oh no, my Lord," he cried out. "It was borrowed." The man of God asked, "Where did it fall?" And when he showed him the place, Elisha cut a stick and threw it there and made the iron float. "Lift it out," Elisha said. Then the man reached out his hand and took it. Absolutely crazy story. Just a few short verses, and I'm guessing for some of us, we've read the story before, and we've just kind of breezed on past it without going, what just happened in this story? But there's a couple of things that I believe God wants for us to catch and to hear this morning as we read this story. And one of them is that God cares. God cares about what happens and what goes on in your life. When this young prophet goes towards the Jordan, he is there to try to build this school, and he is chopping down the tree. The axe head splashes in the water, and it is a big deal for two reasons. The axe is valuable, and it's borrowed. And the young man begins to worry about what is going to happen. And he begins to feel the weight of, I cannot afford to purchase another axe head. And the axe head isn't even mine. So there's a relationship that I have with whomever it is that I borrowed this with. And that relationship is now severed or strained because I have lost something that belongs to somebody else. Now the text doesn't say it explicitly. But part of me wonders, because this young man is human, if human nature kicks in here a little bit. And even in the midst of his stress and his worry, I've lost something that is valuable, I've hindered a relationship in my life, but I wonder if there's a temptation to trivialize his issue before God. To say, God has bigger things that he has to deal with. At this time, he would have been praying that God would protect the nation of Israel from invading armies. They lived in the land of Canaan, and so many nations were constantly causing military trouble for the people of Israel. He could have reasoned that God was dealing with immoral politicians. The land of Israel never had a king who honored God, and Judah rarely did. They were regularly crying out, those who loved the Lord, for God to intervene in the government situations. He could have said, God, you are busy caring for suffering people. The economy was a poor economy at the time, and people suffer for lack of resources. The reason I wonder this is because so often this is our human nature. We act this way with God, like the things in our life really don't matter as much as all of the other things that God has to deal with. And so we're going through a situation, and for us, the situation is hard and it is difficult. Something has been lost, a relationship has been strained, and it is worrisome and it is stressful. But when we begin to think about God, we're like, yo, God, I'm gonna do you a solid here. I'll take all of the worry and all of the anxiety upon myself. Why? Why do we limit the power of God and his ability to pay attention to every detail of our lives? Sometimes we carry around extra stress simply because we fail to see God for who he really is. So often we project ourselves onto God rather than allowing God to impress himself upon us. Say that again. So often we project ourselves onto God rather than allowing God to impress himself upon us. Maybe you remember a time or a situation in your life where you approached a parent or a teacher or a boss, and you had an issue that seemed so important to you. Mommy, 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 I stubbed my toe. Mommy, mommy, this really hurts. Mommy, I need some ice. Teacher, teacher, I don't understand. How do I do these problems? This seems so difficult for me. Hey, boss, I've got some ideas for the company. And they responded to us by saying, I'm busy. I can't deal with that issue right now. Or maybe you've been in that spot. You've been the parent. You've been the teacher. You've been the boss. And somebody has come to you with their issue, and you've thought, man, there are so many things going on in my life right now. I can't add one more thing to those. I can't add another issue and deal with one more thing. And at times, we project this onto God. We act like he is so busy that he cannot possibly be bothered with our issue. And the truth is, God cares about the things that happen in our lives. He cares about the things that stress us out and that cause us to worry. And it doesn't matter how big or how small your issue is, God cares. If you have a headache, God cares. If you have a chemistry test, God cares. If your car won't start, God cares. If you can't find a cup that you've already put at the table, God might be laughing at you, but he cares. If you or someone you know is facing a health crisis, God cares. If the financial situation is dire, God cares. Our great big God cares about the details of your life. And contrary to how we sometimes feel, like, God, I'm just going to do you a favor. I'm not going to burden you with this one. I'm not going to spend all kinds of time in prayer with this one, God. I think when we don't offer our cares to God, we rob him of something he considers very precious. We rob him of the opportunity to show us his love. When we don't bring to God what is burdening our lives and lay it before his feet, we rob from God the ability to say, I'm there and I'm present and I'm walking with you in the midst of your situation. I'm going to pause for one more second. I know I'm still crackling, so we're going to try one more thing here. We're fighting each other with the sound team, I think. Mute, unmute, mute, unmute, up, down. We good?
Yeah.
For a moment, anyways. When your microphone doesn't work, God cares. And hopefully, maybe that'll still be an illustration of the next point that I think God wants us to understand, is that God can help you find what you didn't mean to lose. This is the central theme of this passage. The young prophet didn't set out trying to lose the axe head. He wasn't going out and being irresponsible with the thing that was lent to him, the thing that had immense value. He was using it for the purpose that it was there for. He was trying to build the kingdom of God, in a sense. He was building this house that was going to serve as a school for prophets to learn more about God and to share his word in their community. And he chops at the wood, and he chop, 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 whoop, 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 splash. The axe head is gone. But the good news is that God was able to use Elisha to show the young man that God can help you to find what you didn't mean to lose. And what I want to do this morning is talk to you metaphorically about how I think this principle sometimes applies to our spiritual journey. Because for many of us as followers of Jesus, we start out excited. And just like this young prophet, we're excited for what God is doing, and we go out and we're ready to build the kingdom of God. Whatever you call me to do, whatever you ask of me to do, God, I just want more of you in my life. And we are so ready to just be a part of what God is doing. But somehow, for most of us unintentionally, something happens, and we lose our spiritual edge. We lose what we were doing and how we were building the kingdom of God. And we didn't mean to, but just somewhere along the way, we realized the spiritual edge that I had is missing in my life. And so the really big kind of loaded question this morning is, have you lost your spiritual edge? And how did you lose it? And some of you might say, I haven't. I'm still on fire for God. I'm loving Jesus. And in this moment in my life, my heart just swells to see his kingdom grow. I'm experiencing his power and his presence in a regular basis on my life. And if that is you, I just want to celebrate that God is with you. That is so good. Keep doing what you are doing this morning. But my guess is that for many of us gathered here, and even some who may join us online, that for followers of Christ, if we were honest, we would say, if I reflect back over my life, there was some other point in my life when I was more into the things of God than I am today. And so I would ask you to acknowledge specifically and honestly, how have you lost your spiritual edge? For some people, maybe you would recognize that there was a time and you had committed Christians that were gathered around you. And you regularly spent time and you were transparent with one another and you opened up your lives and you opened up God's word and you would talk about what was going on and you would take time to pray for one another and to encourage one another in the things that mattered. But as you look around your life now, you have some Christian friends, but you're not really building each other up in the things of God. You've kind of lost your spiritual edge because of that. For some of you, maybe there was a time when you served in our church and you had this thrill of just being used by God. And it was difficult, and sometimes you didn't quite know what you were doing, but you were just committed to saying, I want to build God's kingdom. And God was just showing up and his Holy Spirit was there. But somewhere along the way, you kind of got busy. And you said, I need to step back a little bit. And you had all of these intentions, like, I'm going to go back to it in a little bit, but you just kind of continued to get busy. And you never really got back to serving, and you're missing something in your life because you used to know what it was like to be used by God. But now, if you're honest, life is pretty much about you and your schedule. Some of you, maybe there was a time when your life was characterized by a passion for prayer. Maybe you got up early in the morning or you stayed up late at night, or maybe you had these long lists of people that you were praying for and you would just pour out your heart to God. And you would regularly sense that God's Spirit was just connecting with your heart and that the kingdom of God was moving and that spiritual battle was being done as you were on your knees before the Lord. But if you're honest now, maybe you pray over a meal every now and again. Or when somebody's watching, you add a few flowery words. But the truth is, you haven't prayed in a significant way in a very long time. Maybe for some, there was a point in your life where you loved to share your faith with people. You had this deep passion for people who didn't yet know Jesus. And you would just love to meet them and you'd listen to their story. And you'd say, oh, let me share with you my story. I once was this way, but Jesus came into my life and I've been so transformed and I'm just living with him in the everyday moments. And you would just share your story with anybody who would listen. But something happened. And even though you used to be really trying to help others without Christ, now you really can't even remember the last time you had a spiritual conversation with someone who wasn't a follower of Jesus. For some of you, maybe if you're really honest, you'd notice your standards have eroded. Years ago, you had these values, and there were things that you said, I will not, because God's word tells me not to go there. There are things I will always do, because that is how I can know God. And you lived your life based on the standards of Scripture. But then something happened. You got a set of friends or some people that you got around, and they're like, come on, let's do this. And you're thinking, well, maybe just this one time, but before long, you started cutting corners and taking shortcuts and doing things that you probably shouldn't have been. And now, if you're honest, you wonder, how did I get here when I used to be there? The reality is that it can happen to any one of us. We lose our spiritual edge that we have for the kingdom of God because you have an enemy. He prowls around like a roaring lion. And his purpose in your life is to steal, kill, and destroy. He wants to remove your faith so that you don't see God, so that you don't experience the presence of the Holy Spirit in your life, so that you're not doing things that grow, build, and serve the kingdom of God, so that your eyesight is fixed on your problems and your situation or the high that you can get on your own that has nothing to do with Him. And the enemy wants to rob you of everything that is precious to the heart of God and everything that matters to you. And so for so many of us, it just looks like spiritual drift over a slow period of time where we used to be so close to God, and now our spiritual edge is lost. We used to be building the kingdom of God, but the faith that we had, the experience of the presence of God, it wasn't ours. It had immense value. It was bought with a great price, and we borrow it by grace because He gives it to us. But somewhere along the way of using it, it got lost. It splashed in the river. And the really good news for us this morning, though, is that God can help you to find what you didn't mean to lose. So let's talk about how He does this. First of all, you got to be honest about where you lost it. The first step to getting your spiritual edge back is just to be honest about where you lost it. The young prophet, as he loses the iron axe head in the water, comes to Elisha, says, "Oh no, my Lord, it was borrowed." And in verse 6, Elisha just says, "Well, where did it fall?" In other words, what you lost isn't gone, it's where you left it. And similarly, when talking about our spiritual edge, we have to start by asking the question, where'd you lose it? Where did you start to lose your spiritual edge? Because most of us are smart people. And if you look back over your life, you can probably say, "Yeah, I remember where I began to take a wrong turn. I made some friends, and maybe they weren't the right friends, or maybe the influence that they were having on me was not a godly influence. I started dating the wrong guy, and he took me down." Maybe for some of us, we dropped the discipline. We used to pray, and you stopped. You used to be devoted to searching for God and His Word, and you stopped. You used to tithe, and then you kind of got behind on your giving, and you just stopped and wonder why you lost the joy of worshiping and trusting that God that way. You used to, and then you stopped. Maybe you used to be involved in a great community of people like a Bible study or some other group of people that would speak into your life the words and the Spirit of God, and you stopped. Maybe you entered into something you thought was a secret, and you thought it's not going to hurt anyone. But you didn't realize that it wasn't really a secret because God knew about it, and the person it was hurting was you. As it was severing and destroying your relationship with God and rotting your own heart from the inside out. Maybe for some, you got hurt by somebody, maybe even a pastor or someone in a church or some Christian. And you're like, "Hey, if they're going to act that way, then just forget all of them. I can't take this." And you allowed your heart to grow hard and blame God over what someone else did. If you want to recover your spiritual edge, the hardest part is often asking, where did I lose it? Where did I make the wrong turn? Was there even a time in my life when maybe God sent somebody to warn me what was right, but I chose to act differently and I paid for it dearly? A man named Eddie was driving his old rusty pickup down the road. And he could see coming the other direction down the road was a young man in a convertible sports car flying well above the speed limit. And so Eddie swerved his old truck into the other lane, which forced the sports car to slow down. And as the sports car passed, Eddie leaned out the window and said, "Pig!" The man in the sports car turned around and let a few choice words and hand gestures fly. And just then, his car collided with the pig. Sometimes the spot where we, like, you think about that one for a second. Sometimes the spot where we lose our spiritual edge is obvious because God sent someone to warn us. But we were prideful. We had the direction we were going, the speed that felt enjoyable to us. And we wanted to go where we wanted to go. And God allowed somebody else to speak into our lives, but we didn't want to listen to what they had to say. And our pride blinded us. If you want to get your spiritual edge back, the first step is just being honest. It's allowing God to reveal to me, where did I lose it? Where did I make the wrong turn? And even though it is a vulnerable and an uncomfortable and a difficult space, God, where did I lose my spiritual edge? Where did I fall short of all that you had for me? You got to be honest about where you lost it. And then with God's help, take back what you lost. The axe head wasn't gone forever. When the young man lost it in the river, Elisha walks back and he throws a stick into the water and the iron axe head floats. This isn't how science works, friends. And Elisha tells the young man, reach in and grab it. Sometimes there's things that only God can do in your life. And sometimes there's things that he calls you to do. That you can do what you can do and trust God to do what only he can do. In your spiritual life, can you create in your own self, in your own spirit and who you are, spiritual passion and faith and drive for God and service to the kingdom? You can't. You can't in and of yourself do that. But you can know that faith comes by hearing and hearing from the Word of God. And so you can regularly put yourself in a place where you can hear God's word and so build your faith. You know that God hears and answers prayers. So even when there's moments where you don't feel like it, you can spend time in prayer. God's power and presence, he dwells in the praises of his people. So you can choose to put yourself in a place where you gather together with other believers. And even when your heart doesn't feel the warmth yet, you can say, God, I will praise you yet in the midst of everything that I'm going through because you are here. In this, you can choose to share your faith with other people even when you don't know all of the answers to the questions they might ask or even the ones you're asking. You can search for God again. And when you seek him with all of your heart, he promises you will find him. You can take back what's available to you. We've seen a similar principle a few times in the life of Elisha, right? Only God can send the water, but sometimes he calls you to dig the ditch. Only God can multiply the oil, but sometimes he asks you to gather the jars. Only God can make the iron float, but he calls you to lift it out. In your spiritual life, if your spiritual edge has been lost, you cannot allow faith to rise again because of your own willpower. But you can put yourself in the place where you acknowledge before God, this is where I made the wrong turn. And God, even though what I had was borrowed, even though it wasn't mine, even though it was of great value, even though I didn't intentionally set out to lose it, it was lost, God, and this is where I lost it. And by grace, Jesus takes the debt that we owe upon himself on the cross. And he is able to resurrect not only his own body, but our lives, and to say, your spiritual faith does not have to remain buried under the river. Your spiritual edge is not gone forever. I'm going to take you back to the place where you made the wrong decision. And then I want you to realize that it is on me, that I wore the shame, I wore the penalty, I paid the price for you on your behalf, and I am resurrecting what was valuable in your life. I'm resurrecting the edge that you were using for my kingdom. I desire once again for you to have that experience of my power and my presence in your life. Just reach out and take it. It's right there. I died and I rose so that what you didn't mean to lose could be resurrected not by your power but by mine. And I simply ask that you would have the faith to see that I am who I said I am. that I am here. And I'm back there at the moment you made the wrong turn, just waiting for you to come back. All you have to do is repent, turn around, and realize I've already done the work that you can't do. The iron is floating. Your spiritual edge is right there. If by faith, with God's help, you reach out and take back what was lost. Our God cares. Whatever it is you walked in to our church with, whatever it is you clicked online to listen to a video or a podcast with this morning, God cares about what's going on in your life. And he wants to be intimately involved in every aspect and every worry and every concern. And God can help you to find what you didn't mean to lose. Even on your spiritual journey, he can help you if you would just be honest about where you lost it. And with his help, he's already done the work. By faith, simply reach out and take back what you lost. Let me pray for you this morning. Father God, I think of this young prophet, and I can't help but think of the fear that he's got to be facing in this moment when the axe head is lost. It was borrowed, it was valuable, it mattered. God, I think in our lives there's so many things that weigh us down. And I think of the fear that comes into our lives and the enemy uses to control us. To think my life is over, my relationships are broken, everything is wrong, and I don't even know where God is in this situation. How did this happen? I thought I was doing the right thing. I thought I'd made the right choices. I thought I was following you, God. I didn't mean to lose it. I used to be so on fire for you. I used to trust you. I wanted to see you. I was ready to see you. I was trying to. Take us back to those places where if we've made wrong turns, we can acknowledge them before you. And for some of us, God, help us to see again and anew and afresh today that you are still working, you are still active, and you are still powerful. God, iron doesn't float in water just because you throw a stick at it. But God can do what doesn't make sense in our lives. God, you can resurrect something where it feels like everything has been lost. So I pray for our church, and I pray for those listening, and I pray for myself. God, help us to see that you've already done the work, that you are rising something new in our lives again. And help us not to allow the enemy to have his work of fear and discouragement and doubt, defeat. But help us to see that our God is more powerful than anything that happens. And he can resurrect something new. And help us to reach out, God, and take hold by faith of what you are offering and bringing. Help us to take back the spiritual edge. To say, I am going to put myself in a place where once again God's Spirit can be real to me. And I can experience him, and I can listen to his voice, and I can walk with him. Where my life is not about me and the things that I want and the pace that I set and what everybody else thinks and tells me to do, but my life is about his kingdom. Whatever he sets my feet to doing, I will do. Wherever he calls me, I will go. However he wants me, I'm his. God, may we be people of faith who trust in you and who recover what we didn't mean to lose. Because you've already done the work. And as people of faith, we simply reach out and take what you've already made available. God, this morning, we open our hearts to receive you and what you want to give us and what you want to pour into our lives. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Well, want to remind you, you have the ability to worship God through your tithes and offerings again as you exit the sanctuary or online at oakridgewc.com/give. We hope that you will invite somebody and come back. Join us for Father's Day. Next weekend, we're going to have a wonderful celebration of our fathers. We'll have a little gift for any of our adult men who join us as biological or spiritual fathers. We thank you so much for the influence you have. Continue to pray for our kids and our teens as they go off to camp this week. Reminder to our board, we'll be meeting in the pastor's office in just a few moments. Go with God and have a great week. God bless.